Very good afternoon, everyone. We are live now, and I'm really glad that we are having this session. And I'm also extending very good evening and good morning to our participants joined from various parts of the world for this exciting session today. And today's event is one of the milestone moments for in the process of taking the Science Technology Innovation Policy 2020. We are actually launching one of the largest public and expert consultation process for policy making in science and technology. Our very own minister, Honorable Minister Dr. Harshavardhan, Minister for Science, Technology, Earth Sciences, Health and Family Welfare, will be launching this session along with having a first of its conversation in this series with our Secretary, Department of Science and Technology, Professor Ashutosh Sharma. And this event is being live streamed in various platforms. And I request everyone who have joined this event to use the hashtag chat with Dr. Harshavardhan. I repeat, hashtag chat with Dr. Harshavardhan to share their ideas, comments and thoughts, recommendations to reach out to this set of people here. And also beyond that, we will be using all those inputs to deliberations in the policy process. We have our social media volunteers sitting in all the platforms taking those inputs from all of you. So this is going to be a completely participatory experience for all of us. With that, let me quickly give a brief about today's session, although it's going to be pretty back-to-back, tightly knit. We have two segments. The first segment, we have introductory presentations of India's S&T progress by our Secretary, Professor Ashutosh Sharma, and the policy process and framework presentation by Dr. Akhilesh Gupta. Then we will have a launch of MyGov STIC 2020, Science Technology Innovation Policy campaign page on the MyGov portal. We are joined by Shri Abhishek Singh Ji to actually facilitate that. And Minister will be launching that portal today for the country, and people can start using those for the inputs. With that, without further ado, the second segment will be the conversation. Like I said, the first segment completes with the MyGov launch, and the second segment starts with the conversation between Minister and Secretary. That will be the program for today. With that, without further ado, let me again welcome all of you, those who joined on panel and on participant list and on extended network of online YouTube, Twitter and Facebook. I'll now hand it over to Professor Ashutosh Sharma to begin this session and to give a presentation on India's recent progress on science, technology and innovation. Over to you, Professor Sharma.
Thank you, Shagun. Today is a great day. This could be a historical day. And I'm delighted that our Honorable Minister of Science and Technology and Earth Sciences and Health and Family Welfare has joined us today, because it was under his vision and leadership that extraordinary things have happened in the last 6 years in the area of science and technology. And today we want to discuss, starting today, a new policy for science, technology and innovation 2020. So we need to build on the foundations that have been laid in the last 6 years. So before we go down that path, I would present to you the briefest possible description of the major things that have happened in the last 6 years in science and technology. Now, of course, you would realize that 20 minutes certainly is not sufficient to sum up last 6 years across four of the departments. So these are departments of Science and Technology, Department of Biotechnology, CSIR, and Ministry of Earth Sciences. So what I will focus on are the major directions, the major themes, and what is the vision behind it all, just to get a little glimpse of where we have been, where we are headed, and what are the policy implications of this vision and the foundation.
Professor Sharma, may I start your video before the PPT?
Yeah, so let's have a very quick video about some of the things which have been going on.
King of science and technology, propelling 2020, low-cost innovations have made healthcare accessible to lakhs of people, boosting as much our vision. Rural S&T interventions for sustainable development, like transport aircrafts are thus developed. Indigenous mathematical models and high computing for better prediction than our current.
Over to you,
Prasashant.
I'm sharing your PPT now.
Okay, Sharun, I was just signaling you to unmute me. Okay, it's wonderful. So, you see, every policy hangs on some basic vision of where we are and the direction in which we want to move. The components of vision and direction that have been given to us consistently over the last 6 years in many different forms can be summarized in this slide. So this is about enhancing quality of our science and technology and relevance of science and technology. These are the twin pillars on which everything in science and technology hangs. We need a translation of our science and technology into innovation and going to market and going to society. Connecting academia, R&D, industry, startups, MSME, ministry, the whole ecosystem of the knowledge. Clearly, societal connect and our societal contract of science and technology is very important. So basically, we want our science to work for people and we would have people engaged in doing science. So science for people and people for science are the twin mottos of how we have been working in the arena of science, technology and innovation in the last 6 years. Diversity and inclusion are very important. Clearly, diversity and inclusion are about gender, about age, about empowering our youth. It's about geographical location. It's about socioeconomic strata. So all of that will empower our science and technology if the participation of all walks of life is inclusive. And finally, aligning our science and technology to national priorities. Now, these national priorities, of course, we are going through the times of COVID-19. So we know that health is a big
priority,
and so is water, energy, transport, manufacturing, waste processing, sanitation, industry, and of course the overarching challenges of the future, which include sustainable development, environment, climate, livelihood, skills, and making use of our demographic dividend. So these are some of the pillars based on which our science and technology has to propel in the future. Chagun, could you please change the slide? I'm on slide 3 now. All areas of science, technology and innovation are covered under the Ministry of Science and Technology and Earth Sciences. So it covers everything from atoms to astrophysics, everything in between. It also covers everything from R&D to translation, to technology development, to human resources, to innovation and startups, going to industry and market, and all the processes of the government. So our stakeholder base is very wide. It includes all segments, all stakeholders of science and technology, going from universities, IITs, R&D institutions, students, school students to higher education, scientists, researchers, women scientists, youth, scientists of weaker segments, innovators, entrepreneurs, startups, industry, community-based organizations, NGOs, with grassroots work, state governments, line ministries, international partnerships and connects, farmers, fishermen, artisans. So basically, this is a very quick snapshot just to point out that science and technology is not only about only the high tech or only industry, but it permeates all sections of society. And therefore, our science and technology has to be something that serves the needs of all the segments of our society. Science and technology is not a vertical, but a horizontal of knowledge, because it goes across all sectors and all segments of society. I would now just tell as very indicative and very quickly about some of the new programs which also tell us about the new directions. The new programs of Department of Science and Technology, one theme which runs into all the departments of science and technology is related to being future ready, because we live in times which are times of disruptive technologies, which are times of exponential technologies. Some examples are National Supercomputing Mission at an investment of 4,500 crores, which is now we are making supercomputers in India and designing them in India, except at the chip level. So everything else is being designed and assembled in India. Already 6 supercomputers have been established, and our objectives are very ambitious to have an array of 70 supercomputers to deal with all areas of science and technology and service of science and technology to society. A new mission on cyber physical systems was launched last year, which includes everything from sensors to robotics to Internet of Things to Industry 4.0 and the applications in all the different sectors. This is at an investment of 3,660 crores. A mission in quantum technologies, which we know are the disruptive technologies of the future, is in the offing at an investment of 8,000 crores. And this would make us totally future ready in disruptive technologies like quantum computing, quantum communication, cryptography, quantum sensors, quantum algorithms. So the whole world is very fired up about these new set of technologies, and we are not behind in the rest of the world, because we started working on quantum technologies even 3 years ago. Innovation, startups and industry is the way forward to convert the fruits of our basic R&D to new socioeconomic opportunities. There are several new programs. In fact, more technology incubators have been made in the last 5 years as compared to last 50 years. So certainly this is an idea which has gained muscle. New programs, NIDHI, which is an end-to-end program to encourage all the stages of innovation and startup. A MANAC program takes the mantra of innovation to school students. Up to 100,000 school students are chosen based on the power of their ideas. They are given mentorship and 10,000 rupees each in order to motivate them, in order to empower them, in order for them to become the entrepreneurs of tomorrow. Another very interesting program, Saathi, it is setting up centers with sophisticated facilities which are required for industry, required for MSMEs, required for startups, because they often do not have access or very easy access to these high-end instruments, infrastructure and information. So all of that is going to be provided to industry at large by these centers, each of these centers at an investment of 150 crores. Next slide. In terms of addressing national priorities, there are new programs in advanced manufacturing, waste processing technologies, emission innovation, which is focused on smart grids, clean energy, bioenergy, in collaboration with Department of Biotechnology, and digital mapping of India. Because all our development needs, our governance, all of that depends on having very good maps of India at a resolution and accuracy of 10 centimeters using the latest technologies like LiDAR and drones. This mission has started with a lot of energy and going forward very quickly. Another very important aspect of doing science is communicating it to all the stakeholders of science and technology and society in general. And India Internet TV, India Science Internet TV with a huge library has been established. I request all of you to visit this. It's a huge resource. A new program called Avsar started in order to encourage our PhD students and young scientists to write popular science stories based on the area of their research. So idea is that we convert our scientists also into popular science writers because they know their science well. Now they have to explain it to our people, to our youth, to excite them. And I'm very happy to report that just 1 year, we received more than 5,000 entries, of which top 100 entries, popular science stories have been rewarded, and they have been mentored to write even better stories. There is a new India Science Tech and Innovation Portal, which gives a 360 degree view of everything which is happening in science and technology in the country. Next. Department of Biotechnology, finally, we need to empower quality science. So new programs, Vajra, for example, brings the best of global science and scientists to the country so that they can collaborate with our scientists, they can co-guide our PhD students. About 100 of these top scientists from abroad are already visiting us under this program. Vigyan Jyoti program is creating women scientist leaders, which means that in the underrepresented areas like technology, we would scout, train, motivate them and empower them to join the top institutes of technology and also have a pipeline for their career progression. Another program called Supra allows scientists to work on projects, to work on problems which have high risk, but if they succeed, it would lead to something profound. So this is to encourage profound research, high risk research, but to move away from small time incremental research. And finally, about policies. Policies are very important. Two policies are already in the final stages. The first one about S&T infrastructure facility. This is all about how to create infrastructure properly, effectively, how to share infrastructure, how to maintain infrastructure, how to dispose of infrastructure. So because we have a lot of infrastructure, we create tens of thousands crores worth of infrastructure every year. So clearly having a very clear vision about this would go a long way. And other one is about the scientific social responsibility, something which is very close to the heart of our Honorable Minister. Scientific social responsibility is about how do we reach society using all the tools at our disposal. These tools are our infrastructure, these tools are our human resources, these tools are our information about science, technology and innovation. So in every possible way that we can empower different segments of society, whether it is MSME, students, farmers, everybody, if we can connect with them and have an interface to do that, that would be a transformative change indeed. And finally, we are meeting up on the Science, Technology and Innovation Policy 2020 today. And that would be an overarching policy that takes into account all our strengths and builds upon them. Next. Department of Biotechnology is clearly, in health and agriculture area is of great importance. They have developed many new varieties of cereals, of fruits. Animal vaccines have been developed, diagnostic kits for detection of different animal diseases. First indigenous rotavirus vaccine was developed through DBT knowledge and resources. And of course, we are now in the middle of developing several vaccines in India related to COVID-19. Biobanks have been established and biorepositories for different disease samples have been established, which is a great clinical help. Then they have fostered some of the world's best international cooperation programs And of course, all of these cooperation programs build on the best of our global knowledge and resources. Our new mantra in the last 6 years in connecting globally has been very simple, that it must be based on our need and their strengths. And of course, we return something to them, so that's a win-win situation. But we must not lose sight of what is actually needed by us and who is it who can partner in that very effectively. There has been a vibrant startup innovation system. Adavan, I talked about the startup innovation ecosystem is empowered by all the departments of science and technology, and biotechnology has set up many different incubators and startups in that space. Affordable healthcare is the need of the country, and this includes, for example, mapping of genome of our 10,000 healthy population in order to have a base case. So by having this kind of database, we can understand more about pathophysiology of different diseases and compare them with the healthy population. Agriculture improvement and enhanced productivity in crops has been a very compelling theme in biotechnology, and so is empowering the rural sector. And this is a very interesting program because it has set up 125 Kisan hubs in all the so-called aspirational districts, which benefits directly 1.25 lakh farmers. And so these hubs is a very good model. Once the model is working effectively, this kind of program can be scaled up to reach every district of the country. Similarly, biotech entrepreneurship development, the idea is that once you have the knowledge, you have to convert it to technology, and then you take it to the market, and that happens a whole lot of time through developing entrepreneurship. So there are several bio incubators, about 100 bio incubators that have been set up in this area, and the things are moving with speed and scale forward. Next. Can we have the next slide, please? Also, another very compelling program of biotechnology has been Atal Jai Anusandhan Biotech Mission, which undertakes nationally relevant technology innovation, which also next one promotes maternal and child health and develop predictive tools for preterm birth. A mission that develops affordable vaccines for endemic diseases, development of biofortified and protein-rich meat. To take care of the problem of malnutrition or undernutrition. Then there's mission on antimicrobial resistance for affordable diagnostics and therapeutics. This is going to be one of the greatest challenges of the future. The rise of antimicrobial resistance, as the antibiotics become less and less effective in combating with infections, and everything pretty much rides on antibiotics. Together with many other overarching challenges of the future, which are related to sustainable development, which are related to rise of intelligent machines, which are related to environment and climate and livelihood and the utilization of resources, the antimicrobial resistance remains one of the key factors. All of these overarching challenges of science and technology are being addressed, and they would continue to be addressed even in more effective ways through the Science and Technology and Innovation Policy 2020. Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, CSIR, has many major achievements and missions. For example, making biojet fuel, and many trial runs on that have been done. Import substitution by green treatment or spent wash. Aroma mission. You see, the whole point is that we have lots of raw material, but we have not been treating our raw material very respectfully. This raw material, whether it is about aroma, whether it is about our plant resources, whether it is about mineral resources, whether even now it's about our data, all of this we kind of export without doing value addition to them. And so if we were to do value addition to these things, then their value goes up by 100x, 1000x, 1,000,000x. And so CSIR, whole lot of focus of CSIR is on developing indigenous technologies, especially critical technologies, especially import substitutions, and also looking at how to bring value to our raw material. So there are initiatives about environmental protection and then bringing technology for disaster relief management. And there have been lots of successful stories in dealing with disaster. So you would see that in our newsletter, in our newspapers, in our TV, that the disasters, the natural calamities which have been happening in the last few years, we are able to deal with them much more effectively than before. A new initiative of CSIR is on serological survey of COVID-19. Of course, CSIR, DBT, DST have been very active during the period of COVID-19, and all of us have been able to support science and technology and develop science and technology with very great speed, despite many constraints of supply lines, of human resources, and so on. And CSIR has done some really, really compelling things related to diagnostics and a whole lot of other things. Next. Ministry of Earth Sciences, they are the weathermen of the nation. So, accuracy of weather forecast has gone up multifold. Many new tools of science and technology have been pressed in the service of weather forecast, whether it is supercomputers, whether it is a whole lot of new algorithms, and a very, very deep scientific understanding of weather, of monsoon, and of course, the big daddy of them all, the science of climate change. These are very deep scientific things. So it requires a whole lot of scientists, but also service people working together. In addition to that, there are many advisories which are given to our farmers and to our fishery people so that they are less prone to getting caught up in storms, and they also go to the places where there is more catch, for example, for fishes. Tsunami warning systems, operational oceanography, shoreline protection and management, marine and coastal pollution, and desalination plants are some of the highlights of what the Ministry of Earth Sciences have been involved in, together with seismological services and also looking at the opportunities in polar regions. So in terms of real-time earthquake monitoring and warning systems, doing fundamental research on how do we understand earthquake genesis, and so we can do better management of earthquakes. There are several new big scale research facilities which have come up, and of course a new programs for the poles. These three poles are of course Antarctic, Arctic and the Himalayan poles. Himalayas are very vital for the health of our nation, not to say even globally. But we have to be very great players in understanding Himalayan dynamics, understanding the implications for climate and environment, and making mitigation and adaptation strategies which are required for Himalayan regions to flourish and supply with our needs as well. A very big new Ministry of Earth Sciences initiative is about the Deep Ocean Mission. Deep Ocean is the next frontier, as compelling as the space. So instead of going up, we have to go down, and we have to explore the resources that the ocean offers, and how do we actually reap the benefits of those in a sustainable way. So this mission is going to be a game changer. I would conclude, I would just repeat to say that this is not everything that has happened in science and technology. Clearly, we read maybe 10 to 20 different stories related to science and technology every day. And of course, the ministries of science and technology in various forms are involved with those initiatives, in supporting them, in championing them, in navigating them, and all of that. So many, many, many interesting and deep things have been happening in the arena of science and technology. Indeed, science, technology and innovation are the basic pillars based on which everything else rest. The development, the sustainability, the livelihood, creating skill set, empowering our society in every possible way. So I will stop there. Thank you very much for listening to this very, very brief snapshot. And of course, any of you who have interest in learning more about it, please write to us. Please visit our website. Please visit India Science Channel and all the other resources that are offered. I would now request that we are going to launch today my STIP 2020 page. So Shagun, please take it from there.
Thank you so much, Professor Sharma. I think that was a pretty comprehensive. I'm sure the time cannot do justice to all that what science and technology has achieved so far by these three departments under the Ministry of Science and Technology. Without further ado, let me ask Dr. Akhilesh Gupta to quickly take us through the policies, the foundational process that has come up, and give us some idea, and then we will quickly go to Dr. Hashwal. Over to you, Dr. Gupta. I'm sharing your presentation. There is a slight delay. I will follow as and when you give a comment.
Yeah, thank you, Shagun. Honorable Minister, all the distinguished panelists and the audience at large. So I'm going to be very brief. This is a kind of introduction that I'm giving to the formulation process of District 2020. Can I go to the next slide, please? If you look, just give a background of how the policy processes have gone in the past. There have been four policies after the independence. This first one came in the 1958 as called Scientific Policy Resolution, wherein this was basically focusing on promoting the scientific temper in the country, and this was a kind of top down. When this was created by famous Dr. Homi Bhabha, drafted by him and read by the Prime Minister in the Parliament. So the second policy came, technology policy stated in 1983. This also came as a top-down system, where when India was put under the technology denial regime after the Pokhran One experiment. Then the Prime Minister had come out with this kind of policy where the country should achieve the technological competence and sexual lines. Then came the Science and Technology Policy 2003, and this was the first time that science and technology was brought together, and especially the government had the vision to connect the science with the society. And the also the first time that innovation system was talked about in this policy. And the last policy was of course the 2013 policy, which is called Science and Technology Innovation Policy, came at the time when the International Innovation Decade was being celebrated. All said and done, all these policies were largely, I would say that these initial policies were largely cut down, although the last two policies have some bottom-up process and also a wide range consultation. But the policy that we are in fact proposing now, in fact, is that it primarily has been based on these five pillars. It will be bottom-up, decentralized, expert-driven, evidence-supported, and inclusive. And that is the difference between the rest of the policy that we had formulated in the past. The entire policy formulation process has been divided into four tracks. The first track is called extended public and expert consultation, which has been divided into several actions. I will come to that after this slide. The track two is a thematic group consultation, where the large number of experts were drawn to prepare a skeleton of the policy draft. so that, you know, we get idea as to what are the issues that the country is facing and put together everything. So this was basically an expert web that we have been created as a part of the Track 2. Track 3 was, in fact, this is again for the first time that the states are being consulted in the science and technology innovation policy formulation formally. I mean, there were some kind of informal consultation in the earlier policy years, but we are involving states into a formal process of consultation, and also the ministries are being involved. And the last track is the track where the effects level discussions at the institutional heads level have been planned. The track one, which is the public consultation, has six main actions or the elements of actions that we have put in. So the first action in the public dialogue series with thought leaders and public scholar, which we call it in conversation with an on-level minister, in fact, is launching this activity today. With he is the first thought leader with whom we are having consultation and discussion. Then we had the thematic panel discussion with public engagement. There were 16 such panels were created for public engagements. The third one is the targeted surveys. This set of questionnaires have been created, and then the people at large have been asked to participate in this. So anybody, all of you can participate in the targeted survey. They are in fact in regional language as well. So anybody of any age, from any part of India, even abroad, can participate in these targeted survey. Print media also, we have been trying to reach out to the people through our articles. So many science communicators have been writing these articles so that people can be motivated to participate in the policy formulation process. We are also having this community podcast created already in the Ministry of Information and Broadcasting is collaborating with us, and we are reaching out to the last mile connectivity by bi-directional process. This has, in fact, we have been trying to reach out that, you know, every in fact, last mile person in this through this way. And last one is a very innovative idea of going for an idea-based, you know, participation where people have the people can post their ideas on the idea thon on in any form, like they can give some articles, or they can give some kind of cartoons or any such kind of, even the video and audio clippings can be posted on the, and they have kept some prizes for this. So with that, thank you very much. This was our brief introduction to the SCIP policy that we are formulating. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's helpful that we touched upon the complete framework that laid for public participation in this policy process, and also how this whole policy is going to be an entire participatory approach. I think we have Abhishek Singh Ji from MyGov, who has developed a MyGov campaign page to be launched today by our Honorable Minister. I request Abhishek Ji to briefly tell about how MyGov is participating in this process and enabling participatory policy making in science, technology and innovation. Over to you, Abhishek.
Thank you, Chaturji. It's my honor and privilege to be in this forum with Honorable Minister for Science and Technology amongst us today at the historic occasion from the launch of the STIP campaign page and the whole endeavor of the Department of Science and Technology to involve the stakeholders in giving inputs for policy formulation. We have seen through the great achievements that the department has been taking up in the last few years, and especially even during COVID times, and the leadership of the Minister and the Secretary of the Department of Science and Technology and all the officers of the Department of Science and Technology, it's indeed a great opportunity, and it's an honor for MyGov to be part of this process. MyGov, as we all know, was launched by Honorable Prime Minister 6 years back on 26 July 2014. With an objective to enable citizen engagement, with an objective to give a voice to the citizens in policy making and ensure participative governance in a true sense. So we have been doing, we have been working with various ministries in this direction, where citizens' opinions are taken into by policy formulation, and Department of Science and Technology has been one of the most active partners of MyGov in this endeavor. We have been collaborating on several events in the past, and this STIP initiative also is a step in that direction. The STIP campaign page, which has been launched today, has been set up on the MyGov portal. It's accessible on mygov.in/STIP, and users can log in there and they can join in the conversation. They can give the inputs about the STIP policy. We are also in the process of launching a STIP quiz with regard to the science technology. And then we will be covering the 6 broad themes that have been mentioned by Mr. Chapul with regard to in a conversation with wherein public, wherein experts' consultation will be done on the platform or across the table, in which there will be specific conversations, discussions with regard to experts in various domains of human science technology, or the policy compass, which will be the key forum wherein suggestions of citizens and stakeholders will be invited for the finalization of the STIP policy. The open letter is a very innovative concept wherein anybody can write to the ministry, and those inputs will be taken into consideration by the Department of Science and Technology. Then the podcast series, The Thoughts for India, is a very interesting and innovative concept at MyGov. Also, what we have found is that whenever we have used the radio as a medium, Honorable Prime Minister uses it every month in the Mann Ki Baat broadcast. So podcast has the reach which is much more than any other channel that we have. And it brings in inclusion in the right sense. So even those who don't have smartphones and who don't have apps like YouTube or something, they can listen to a conversation on radio and be inspired with. So the partnership that the Department of Science and Technology has with community radio channels will go a long way in enabling this objective. And the ideation is something that is the most exciting part for young entrepreneurs, the college students and all, wherein they can think of their ideas and get a platform on this this initiative, wherein the ideas can be discussed with experts, get mentoring, and ideas can lead to incubation and ultimately to a prototype screen and building products. So that is the innovation life cycle from which we have been working on the Atmanirbhar Bharat initiative that MyGov launched, whether it was the app innovation challenge, the video conference innovation challenge. So now those experiences that MyGov has will come in handy, and we promise, we commit ourselves to extend the fullest support to Department of Science and Technology in ensuring that every initiative of Department of Science and Technology reaches every nook and corner of India. Every citizen is aware of what we are doing. We disseminate information from our side, we collect input from ground up, and ensure that holistic policy making with correct input from all stakeholders is achieved. So I am proud to be associated with this initiative, congratulate the department for this wonderful concept. And this portal will definitely, already we are getting a lot of feedback with regard to this YouTube broadcast, but our analytics team is working on it. The trend that you mentioned, the chat with the Honorable Minister, is trending on Twitter. My team is reporting to me as we go into the event live, and we are getting like inputs are coming from all over the country, including Kolkata is the most active right now, my team is saying. But as we say, what I am saying is that scientists across the country are very excited about this. And this is one of the true barometer with regard to whether we are taking all inputs in doing or whatever we are doing. So I once again congratulate the entire team of the Department of Science and Technology, and especially our Honorable Minister under whose vision and direction this initiative is being launched, and extend my fullest of support and cooperation to the department for making this initiative a success. Thank you.
Thank you. To launch the MyGov campaign page from your side, I think Sachin ji is there who will be operating it, and Honorable Minister Dr. Harshavardhan will be launching it. Given all the challenges that we have in virtual meetings, I think this is the most innovative way that we could do for a more or less nearest real launch. And this is the MyGov page that Abhishek ji was mentioning. And it features all the events that we talked about for public participation. It's live from now. And thank you so much, MyGov ji, for your team and everybody who worked hard to put this together. Can you go down a bit, and we have all the features of this whole policy mentioned here, and then the details completely transparently mentioned, all the four tracks that we are engaging, and then all the activities also just mentioned here for anybody to engage. In conversation with that the minister is launching today, it's the first one to start with, and other activities are also mentioned for anybody to engage with. With that, thank you so much, Abhishek ji, and thank you so much, Sachin ji, from minister's side, and thank you so much, Honorable Minister Ashwadhan ji, for launching this. Now I'll hand it over to my co-moderator, Dr. Nimita Pandey, to initiate the second segment of today's event. Over to you, Dr. Nimita.
Thank you, Dr. Shagun, and thank you once again to Shri Singh for his remarks and for the launch event. I thank the Honorable Minister for launching the MyGov campaign page. And now I would request Honorable Minister Dr. Harshvardhan to address the gathering and provide his valuable thoughts on science, technology, innovation in India. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Namita. Professor Ashutosh Sharma, Secretary, Science and Technology. Dr. Akhilesh Gupta. Shri Abhishek Singh Ji, CEO MyGov. The two important people moderating this function, Dr. Shagun Basha and Dr. Namita Pandey. All the participants who have given us the privilege of being with us today within the country and outside the country, all our scientific fraternity friends, young researchers, media personnel, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great day and a great moment, and it's very difficult to describe my feelings in words at this particular moment. I know that the first science and technology innovation policy was thought of and launched in 1958. The second one took 25 years to come in 1983. The third one, another 20 years in 2003, the fourth one another 10 years in 2013, and this 2020 Science and Technology Innovation Policy is coming after 7 years. The 7 years have seen a very distinct change in the science and technology scenario of the country. And it is not only the science and technology scenario, but the overall scenario has seen a sea change in all fields, because this country was blessed with a very, very dynamic and a visionary leader like Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji. It would be difficult to describe the ability, the enthusiasm, and the vision, and the energy with which Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji has been serving the millions of this country for the last 7 years with thorough commitment, dedication, sincerity, honesty, and whatever good you can think about him. His only mission is to develop and deliver a new India. Now he is calling it an Atmanirbhar Bharat, and ultimately he wants India to become a Vishwa Guru Bharat. For me, it was the greatest blessing of the Prime Minister Narendra Modi in the month of November 2014, when he asked me, directed me to look after the science and technology ministry of the country. All my life I had worked in the field of health in various capacities as a medical student, as a medical association activist, as a health minister in Delhi, and prior to November 2014 for about 6 months as a union health minister, and also for a couple of years as an advisor to the World Health Organization. Health had always been my life, my passion, my soul, and I used to live health, I used to like health, I used to dream about health. But the greatest thing that I always feel that has happened to me was on 9th of November 2014 when I got this new portfolio of Science and Technology Ministry. And I find and feel very strongly that this was a great privilege that I enjoyed working with scientists all across the country in all fields. And it was particularly privileged to have enjoyed the blessings of the Prime Minister, who has so much of confidence in the ability of science and the scientific community to turn around everything. He feels that if the country's people are still suffering from so many issues, so many problems, so many sufferings of various nature in various fields, science has the ability to alleviate their sufferings. I also did not believe it till the time I actually visited science professionals, scientific laboratories, and people working with utmost sincerity and dedication in all fields of science. The journey of the last 6 years in the various science laboratories has been moments of joy and great satisfaction for me, which I really can't describe. And today, when I am at this function where we are trying to work out a strategy where we involve everyone in this country from every nook and corner, poor or rich, academician or an industrialist, people from all strata of life, everybody, we want to make this new science and technology policy thoroughly inclusive. And as was described by Dr. Akhilesh Gupta, I do not want to repeat any of those things. But when you have a visionary leader like Prime Minister Narendra Modi, people who are watching and who have seen the slides just now, which depicted in brief what the Department of Science and Technology has been able to achieve, what the biotechnology people have been able to achieve, what the earth sciences and CSIR has been able to achieve, not to talk of people in DRDO and in ISRO and other departments where science is happening in a big way, but since they don't directly fall in under the domain of my ministry, so they have not talked about it here. I can tell everyone who is watching this program that whatever has been shown by Dr. Ashutosh Sharma, it is just about the tip of the iceberg, and it's really very difficult to describe the great achievements. When we talk of these achievements, I can say with utmost confidence that whatever Indian scientists are doing in India, we are inferior in no sense to anyone performing the best in the whole world. And in number of fields, we are probably performing much better than the rest of the world. Today, if I have to talk about only a couple of statistics, we are third in the whole world in terms of our publications in science journals, third in number of PhDs, third in the whole world in nanotechnology, third in the size of higher education, third in the number of startups that we have in this country, over 32,000, third in the number of unicorns, and our global innovation index, we need to go further up. It's from 81st, we have come to 52nd position. Ease of doing business, we have come down from 142 to 63. And in last 6 years itself, participation of women in science has doubled. And India's R&D personnel, research and development personnel, that's about 3.42 lakhs. Almost 40% higher than in the last 6 years from 2014. We are ranked 12th in science and research output. And when I talk of other places, CSIR, it is ranked first in the Nature Ranking Index today based on the total research output by its institutions in 2018-19. And following it is another Indian institution, that's the Indian Institute of Science. Our Jawaharlal Nehru Institute, our Center for Advanced Scientific Research, autonomous under our DST, Department of Science and Technology, is ranked 7th amongst the top 10 institutions. I know that in a list of over 1200 institutions in the whole world, which are supported by government money, which are public institutions, CSIR has always been in the first 15 or 20 or so. I think these are all extraordinary achievements. When we talk of early tsunami warnings in a country under Prime Minister Narendra Modi, a country which was caught unaware in 2004 because of a devastating tsunami killing millions of people or making them homeless, today we are ranked number one in the whole world. Our weather forecasting systems are almost ranked fourth in the world, where we have right now a 9 petaflop facility, which in the immediate future, 1 or 2 years, we want to take it up to 40 petaflops. So many achievements. You talk of any parameter, I have a huge list, maybe during the course of the program we talk about them. I think science and our scientists have done remarkably well, and I have seen in recent COVID times also. It was not only my COVID warriors like doctors and nurses and the health staff in the hospitals or the sanitation and the security staff working there. It was the backing of the scientists in various fields, whether it was biotechnologists or the ICMR scientists isolating the virus, doing the genome sequencing of the virus. I think they did it for more than 1,000 viruses, developing the new vaccines, developing the new kits, developing the new ELISA test, developing a new ventilator in the science laboratory. So many things have happened. I have to thank the scientific community. And I would use this particular occasion to also, because nothing could have given me the pleasure than this knowledge and information that the MyGov portal, which is probably one of the most respected portal in the country, or maybe if I say in the world, it may not be an exaggeration, a brainchild of our Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi ji, And when we see that the science and technology campaign page is going to be there, we are going to have a special popularization science quiz there for children. I have to only thank Shri Abhishek Singh ji in no uncertain terms. I think thank you so much for helping us in strengthening this participation movement from the people of India. I would like to use this occasion to appeal to every scientist, every researcher, every right-thinking man, all across the spectrum. This science and technology innovation policy is not only about the scientific community. It is about the people of India. And what our Prime Minister has been repeatedly emphasizing to the scientific community is, please remember your scientific social responsibility. It's not only about doing research and producing something which glorifies our paper, our CV, but it is about diagnosing what the problems of the country are, diagnosing what the sufferings of the people of India are, and then trying to solve those problems through science. Discover things at the grassroots level, indigenous things, how we can ensure that the R&D products and our indigenous thinking, we can blend everything together. I am sure that once we are able to ensure that there is a good quality participation of people for guiding us about this science and technology innovation policy, the policy that will be delivered after all this comprehensive, all-inclusive approach is going to make things change radically for the country. And we are running against time. In 2017, at a function where I was also present, Prime Minister of India said, imagine we are in 1942 and 5 years from then we achieved independence. And in 2017 at a function he said, 2022 will be the year when we shall complete 75 years of our independence. And very categorically he said, I have nurtured a dream. I want to deliver a new India to every Indian. And he wants an India where every tear is wiped, every face has a restored smile, every child has enough of health, education, nutrition, all these concerns addressed properly. Every woman and every old man, every senior, his interests are looked after. And the country lives with a dream of delivering a new India. I am sure after having worked in science and technology for last 6 years continuously and having watched everything very meticulously without any prejudice, I can say with conviction that if there is one department which has the real potential to help our Prime Minister in delivering this new India of his dreams, it is the Science and Technology Department. And the scientists have a new responsibility. And our countrymen, if you can advise the scientific community for helping us in devising a very good science and technology policy, I can promise you on behalf of the scientific community of India that we shall work day in and day out with all the wisdom at our command, with all the sincerity at our command, and ensure that your ideas are nurtured properly, they are taken care of properly. We convert your ideas into very definite programs, and like what we have learned from our Prime Minister, we will convert those ideas into visionary programs, and then we start implementing those visionary programs. And not only we will implement them, we will very meticulously monitor their implementation and ultimately bring back to India your suggestions and your ideas converted into fruits of research which will help you better your lives. And this is a moment where the students, the young researchers, the scientists, the young startups, the young entrepreneurs, they all, along with the academic people and the guidance and support of the industry, these all, they have to work together. They have to put their heart and soul into this pious movement. And when we enjoy a new India in 2022, or when, as per the dream of our Prime Minister, in 2030 he wants India to be amongst the top 2-3 scientific nations of the whole world in all respects, I am sure at that time all of us will live and enjoy, and we will all have the satisfaction that we have all been participants and contributors in this new happy India, which has the potential to once again show the best possible path for the whole world to follow. So I think I will stop with this. Once again, congratulate all my colleagues in Science and Technology Ministry, all my scientific friends all over the country, and once again thank MyGov, and of course our dear Prime Minister, whose blessings we have always enjoyed, and we work with so much of enthusiasm because we see him working like that all the time. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Harshvardhan, for that clear commitment and assurance and the strong power of words that you expressed towards the scientific community and the call for participation in this policy-making exercise. I think now we are entering into an exciting session where Secretary Ashutosh Sharma would be engaging with you in terms of a dialogue as a start of this In Conversation series. Over to you, Dr. Sharma.
Thank you, Chairman. Actually, even I was thinking about asking questions, it so happens that the minister has already answered all of them. So that's very good. And the reason he has already anticipated and answered all of them is because he has such an in-depth knowledge of everything related to science and technology. So you are a medical doctor yourself, and as you pointed out, that you have visited all the 80 R&D labs of the Ministry of Science and Technology, Earth Sciences as well, and I do recall every time that you came back from somewhere, you had such a positive things to say about the science and the scientists and the labs and the great work that they are doing there. Now you have also been you have had a very unique insight because you have been Minister both of Health and Science and Technology, and these are the two domains of knowledge and service that have come together rather seamlessly in the time of COVID-19. To solve many of our problems, including health, energy, water, everything, clearly science and technology plays a vital role, as you already pointed out, sir. Now, based on your experience, knowing how deep and how wide our science is, and the infrastructure, and all the creative people, how can we leverage all of that for our policy so that this policy empowers us even more, that it would help us build on the foundations which are already very strong, have become stronger in the last 6 years. So sir, a lot of people want to know what could be the insights, what could be the areas, what could be processes by which we can bring all this insight into our policy. Of course, you already touched upon many of these points, but so in terms of context of the policy, if there is some other insight that you know you could share with our listeners.
Well, thank you, Dr. Ashutosh Sharma. You have rightly said that I had the privilege to visit each and every laboratory in this country. And in my first round, when I finished with all the laboratories in CSIR, biotechnology, DST, and then in Earth Sciences Ministry. So I had the curiosity, so I started visiting the ISRO labs also, and I started visiting some of these places where a lot of activities around agricultural research and all is happening. And when I say this with so much of commitment, that our scientists are doing a fantastic job in almost every field. You have mentioned about even from small things to the highest level of research, whether it is a super computing mission or the biggest telescope of the whole world. I think in every issue there is a participation. Right now we are working inside the ocean also, going kilometers inside the ocean and trying to search about alternate sources of energy. We are working on polymetallic nodules. I was thrilled to see that I think nowhere in the world there is a research of the type that the Earth Sciences Ministry is doing for the earthquakes. Place in Koyna in Maharashtra district, the Earth Sciences Ministry in a project is going 3-4 kilometers down into the rocky mountains. Literally that's a mountainous areas in a way, because it has been having frequent earthquakes for 50 years, and they are trying to assess what is the cause of that. So they have gone down and put sensors at different places at particular distances, and they are trying to assess the reason by noting down the observations and analyzing those observations continuously for not only months, for years together. The point that I want to emphasize is that already in virtually every field there is so much of experience now, because CSIR, you know, it was born in 1942 and it has 38 labs. Your DST is about 50 years old. The biotechnology department is about 30 years old. Earth Sciences Ministry is also 20-30 years old. In virtually every field, we are already doing so much. We have already achieved so much. I mentioned about some of the achievements. I'll put down a couple of them again, not repeat, but put some more new ones to convince everybody once again that we already have the ability. Now in 70 years down the line, 73 years now, we are also aware of the problems of the country. Like you have seen yourself, right from 2014, the Prime Minister has been trying to diagnose the problems and trying to find out the solutions to those problems, and also using science also for that. You know, he talked about financial inclusion, he talked about Digital India, he has taken the optical fiber to the last panchayat. Now he is talking about a national digital health mission. So many things. His research in the oceans, providing water to the last man, interlinking of rivers, and everything has the requirement of the support of science. So what I feel that in the new policy, what the Prime Minister also wants, and this is where we want the people to actually contribute, the policy has to be thoroughly people-centric. Now we need to apply our mind, see around ourselves, look at the people, discuss with them, and then see how best we can use and utilize the scientific principles to find out the solutions. And that direction, already there are so many things that we have delivered within the laboratories, but there people are finding it difficult to actually avail the benefits out of those outcomes, because the journey from the laboratory outside to the industry and from the industry to the people of India at an affordable price, for those benefits to be enjoyed by the people, there are bottlenecks, there is a difficulty in that. So everything right now, with the experience of 73 years for the society, the problems, and the experience that our scientific community has gained, we need to put all this together. We need to bring all the right thinking people, all the groups and the think tanks and whosoever we can think of. My personal experience of my life says that even a layman has the ability in his brain to give you the best suggestion. Sometimes what even the most brilliant academician may not be able to deliver, a layman may give you sometimes a great suggestion. That is what should be the thrust of our search for good ideas for incorporation in the science and technology policy. I would just like to highlight for the benefit of the audience some more major achievements that we have enjoyed, like India's gross expenditure on the research and development has increased by more than 3 times in the last 10 years. India's per capita research and development expenditure at PPP got doubled in last 10 years. I said earlier, it was only 2014 when you used to tell me that we are fifth in number of publications in the whole world. Now we are number 3. We are 9th position in number in terms of our quality. We were 13th in 2014. We are 9th rank in terms of resident patent filing. And on 1st April 2018, nearly 5.52 lakh personnel were employed in the R&D establishments in the country, including in-house R&D units of public and private sector industries. I know and you know that we have international collaboration in science and technology with over, I think, 80-90 countries now. And I have myself experienced with you, even while sitting in White House discussing with the scientists across the table from America, while being in South Korea or while being in Israel, many other places. Nowhere in the world we have ever felt that we are probably inferior to them. And nowhere in the world has the other side also not felt that India has become a great superior power now. So with so much of achievements that we already have, with so much of experience and with so much of scientific acumen that we have all witnessed together, and the great thing that has happened in the last 6 years is that, and you will be able to appreciate, Dr. Ashutosh Sharma, that in 2014, within the scientific community, within the science departments, we were working in silos. Now it is no longer silos. It is all the scientific community working together. There is no repetition. All have a great goal ahead of them that they visualize. Whether it is, if it is for water, everybody is working for water. And the best example of this has been the recent COVID outbreak, where it has been under the leadership of our Prime Minister, the total government approach. All departments, it was not only the health department, it was not only the scientific community, but it was every department which was participating in making the fight against COVID glorious fight. Though we lost a few thousand people, we lost so many COVID warriors, our doctors and everybody, but we never lost the spirit to fight unitedly in the most ablest of manners. So what you said just now, what you asked me was, what you need, I think it is, we don't need any big rocket science to think about it. We only need to look at the people of India. Look at their problems. These people are around us. They are in the cities, they are in the villages, they are in the tribal areas, they are all over. And a large number of them are still underserved, underprivileged. They are the have-nots. And we cannot allow them to suffer anymore. I know that your science has the potential to deliver so many things at affordable price to them, which can make their life better. This has to be the thrust of the new science and technology policy. And I am sure we should be able to get great amount of success in developing this policy the way you have thought of starting it, with this type of activity in the public domain, with connect from all over the world. And we have ourselves seen the power of social media. We know the power of social media. You don't have to write an application, you just have to type a few things on the social media and send your suggestions. And with MyGov and everybody involved, I am sure that we are in for a very, very dynamic science and technology innovation policy in 2020. Though it may be remembered for the COVID 2020, 2020 will also be remembered for Prime Minister giving a clarion call for Atmanirbhar Bharat. It will also be remembered for a very dynamic education policy, and it should also be remembered for having another dynamic science and technology innovation policy in the COVID year of 2020. Thank you.
So thank you, sir, for a great deal of clarity about how our science and technology has to work for people. And this is something that we would factor in the policy in a very big way from every angle. So basically it means that when we are talking about Industry 4.0, we really have to see how that would work for Society 5.0 and not the other way around. And the emphasis on grassroots. Sir, I know that you have always been very big champion of grassroots science and technology in the service of people. When I engaged with the National Innovation Foundation, the first mantra I learned is that people on the margins of society are not marginal minds, that they have a great deal to offer. That's something that PhD students will not think about. So the relevant solutions and recognition of problems would have to come from there. And so, as you correctly pointed out, of course, our honorable PM has been saying for a long time in every meeting, in every speech, that the silos have to be broken. Sir, and I remember when you were minister in environment, forest and climate change, you had made a group of ministries to work together, because the problems of environment and climate are indeed very multidisciplinary, and so is everything else that we do. So sir, if you have any suggestions or insights regarding how we should put that in policy, breaking silos, how do we incentivize these silos to work together, how do we see that people see the value in working together. And so this is also true for working with industry, academia working with industry, ministries working together, science working for society at large. All of these silos which we have now, we want this policy to really offer very compelling solutions in breaching these silos and making it happen. Of course, it has been happening because of personal initiative like that of yours. How to make it more systematic, sir? Because this is really the crux of our problem, not just in science and technology, but every walk of life.
I think your question, in fact, has all the answers. You have yourself elaborated, you have yourself highlighted, and you have yourself re-emphasized. Even at the cost of repetition, I would again say that you have again said that we have to break the silos. But this is what you have already, we are already doing it for last couple of years. When you mentioned about the National Innovation Foundation in Gujarat, we have ourselves seen, and we have ourselves seen at the functions which were organized in Rashtrapati Bhavan, when these grassroots innovators, they used to come, they used to be awarded by the President of India. None of them was a very big, high-fi, highly literate person. They had very poor background. Many of them used to come from tribal areas. And we used to scratch our head, how could this man come out with a suggestion like this? I distinctly remember a young boy from a village who had developed a mechanism where if you don't put the helmet and all, then the motorcycle will not start and all, and on the head. We are suffering from so many head injuries and all. So many things that we see there, over 2 lakh innovations produced by the grassroots innovators, which are being exhibited in the through the National Innovation Foundation. And you are yourself highlighting that there is a further need to institutionalize this connect between the scientific laboratory, the people, and the industry. And I distinctly recall that CSIR people, they developed a program where these young boys who were not had not received so much of formal education, they were trained in the CSIR labs. They would spend a couple of months there. They were trained for a situation where they could be used by the industry. We could see that there were many other programs where developed a program like Jigyasa, where the students of the Kendriya Vidyalaya would spend a couple of weeks in the CSIR labs, that was with the HRD ministry. And then when they could see those things happening in the laboratories from closest of quarters, I had once commented that if I had enjoyed this privilege of having seen things happening inside the laboratories when I was a student, I would have opted to become a scientist rather than a doctor. So we now, what there is no push button by which you can eradicate or eliminate the silos. It is through continuous working, and we have to like involve the people in the various strata of society who are relevant for science, who are relevant for producing these scientific outcomes, who are relevant for delivering the fruits of the scientific outcomes to the people of India. We have to actually make sure that with their involvement, now we have the broader picture, and it is now small bottlenecks which are like left here and there, which need to be taken care of. Everything has to be blended, and with the blessing of the Prime Minister, who is a great, not only a votary of eliminating these silos, but who has practiced it and who has shown it last 6 years that this is something which we have learned from him. The way he has been able to tackle this issue in a visionary manner, I think people of India will suggest us what is that they want in the policy which will ensure that right from the day one when we start working, there is nothing like a silos. So in fact, whatever you wanted me to say, you have already answered in your question, and I am sure that with the type of experience that you all have had right now, you also have an experience of working in science technology ministry for over 5 years, being a distinguished chemical engineer from IIT Kanpur. You know that it's only about delivering now. We have already delivered so much, but we now want to focus our delivery mechanisms towards the remaining unsolved, unresolved issues of the people. And then when you mentioned about environment, while I was science and technology minister, and I also had the privilege to be the environment minister, and when I could observe from the closest of quarters things happening to our mother earth because of the global warming and climate change issues, and then I could appreciate in much more greater detail the fact that there is a very strong need for the people in environment and the people in science to sit together, plan together, discuss together, frame out things which will strike a good quality scientific balance between the concerns of environment, concerns of development, and the concerns related to global warming and climate change. And that is why we gave birth to that forum, where the five secretaries of the science ministries and the environment ministry, they started working together, and there was so much that we delivered and tried to work out to handle issues like air pollution and so many others. This is right now not the time to talk in detail about everything. We can keep on talking about all these issues, but once we go with an open mind, with a pragmatic approach, with a sincerity in our thoughts and conviction, and try to reach even the last man in the society and the country, I am sure you will have a very effective, vibrant science and technology innovation policy with you in the next couple of months.
Thank you, sir. We have taken a lot of your precious time. There's just two more things that I also want our listeners to know about. So first one of them is one of the historical weaknesses we have had in science and technology is our connect with the states. Which is that, you know, it looks like almost everything in science and technology is being done with the help of central government. But of course, the fruits of that science and technology have to be in the states. This is where people live. So I just also want to point out, sir, that you are having a meeting with all the ministers of science and technology from states on early next month. The second thing was also connecting very strongly with our diaspora scientists. So while we search for local solutions to local problems, also we connect globally to search for the best of knowledge to do that. And you are having another meeting, sir, with thousands of diaspora scientists again on 5th of September. So these are two different connects which we have not paid too much attention to in the past, especially connect with the states, which should be part of this policy in a very strong way, as to how, you know, that they feel value in coming on board on science and technology and see the resolution of many of their problems to science and technology. So, is there any advice you would have for the policy in these two matters? Strong connect with diaspora scientists and with the states.
Dr. Ashutosh Sharma, you have very rightly diagnosed and highlighted these two issues. Regarding the first issue about the participation of the states, I also strongly feel, very, very strongly, I also feel that in spite of our whatever efforts we could make in this direction, we have not been able to bring the states on board regarding their commitment or their, you can say, attention towards science and technology issues. In most of the states, most of the people in the government, they probably don't know who is their science and technology minister. And as there is a mechanism in every state, there is a science and technology council also, where there are some people belonging to science, representing some organizations, they make a science and technology council. Normally that science and technology council usually doesn't meet at all. I remember having hosted a meeting of the Science and Technology Council with you also there in Jaipur, where it was presided over by the Science and Technology Minister of Rajasthan at that time. But there is definitely a need to bring the state governments with more of commitment for science and technology. It is not only the central government which has to be working in the science laboratories of CSIR and DST. Most of the big laboratories in the country about science and technology, they have been developed by the government of India. There is no doubt about it. But we need to work very hard around this issue. And that is why we had planned a meeting next week with the science and technology ministers also, and I am sure that we have to arouse the type of interest that is required. First, we have to give them the right informations. We have to meet with them more frequently, and once somebody starts appreciating the power of science, I am sure that this will become a movement within their respective states also. Till a couple of years back, we never had so much of attention within the governments for health and education and nutrition issues. But over the last couple of years, we have seen that gradually, once the things become important, once the things are put in the right perspective before the people, and once the people start appreciating the value of those fields, then the governments are also bound to respect those sentiments. And this is where I think the policy may have some specific interventions which will help us in making science popular in a big way. You remember, you know, that last 5 years we have been organizing the India International Science Festival in a big way. And at some of these science festivals, if you remember, the in Lucknow, we had a footfall of 1 million people there. And this was because we did that, we showed that, we saw the involvement of the local government. We did similar activities at other places. We did one in Kolkata, and it was the involvement of thousands of scientists, young and old, young innovators, and we invited 5 students from the adopted village of every parliamentarian. So people all across the country, people within parliament, they started talking about science. They started sending their children to the India International Science Festival. So that is how things start changing. So we have to certainly focus on this diagnosed and highlighted problem by you and work more, you can say, in a more focused manner around this problem. Then regarding the Indian diaspora, we know that there are hundreds and thousands and millions of our intellectuals who are working abroad as scientists. Whatever I have, my own personal experience of having visited the API functions and having visited some of the functions organized by the scientific community in places where we visited together to have these international collaborations in science and technology discussed for various programs. We have seen the people in the diaspora, whether it was the API functions, there I saw the doctors in a big way, and at the scientific forums, these scientists, they have a very strong desire to serve the country. They want to pay back to the country. Many of them want to come back. And you know, with the guidance of our Prime Minister, we have devised so many programs. There are fellowships like the Ramalinga Swami Fellowship, the Vajra program, and so many others through which a lot of scientists have not only come back, but we don't say that everybody should come back. But if we can develop a good quality, continuous contact with these people, and with the digitalization, with the internet, and with all these easy access to communication with everyone, and once we make them aware of what we are doing in India, I am sure that thousands of our diaspora friends, they would be more than willing, if not to come back, but at least to contribute in big way for the development of the science in India in a big way, for sharing what good things they see abroad, for helping us with those great ideas. So it's a great idea that you have thought of about engaging the Indian diaspora, and that function, I am also looking forward to that function with great hope and enthusiasm. And I am sure that our scientific community friends all across the world, if they are listening to us, they will come back to us with new, renewed vigor. And I can promise them that India has changed. There is so much that has happened in India under Prime Minister Narendra Modi. You will love to be part of the development process under his leadership, even if you contribute a good, great idea for the future progress to follow. Thank you.
So it's been a marathon session, and I'm sure all our viewers have been greatly benefited, and it will also increase their desire to participate in the process of formulating the policy. So we would appeal to everybody to connect on MyGov platform, all the platforms. As you have heard Honorable Minister say, that the ideas come from all sides. Ideas, relevant ideas, actionable ideas, they flow from all sides. And so everybody is very welcome to contribute to this journey. Sir, thank you very much for being with us for such a long time, despite so many pressing demands on your time. I would now, sir, with your approval, we would now invite Ms. Namita Pandey to offer a vote of thanks, and then we go pregnant with many ideas which have come up here in this session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Sharma, and thank you, Honorable Minister. Respected Honorable Minister Dr. Harshvardhan, DSP Secretary, Professor Ashutosh Sharma, our dignitaries, colleagues, and all our audience watching us live today, I, on behalf of the SIP 2020 Secretariat and the entire STI community, extend my sincere gratitude for guiding force at Harshvardhan, for gracing this momentous occasion and sharing his thoughts and vision in shaping India's new science, technology and innovation policy, STIP 2020. Under your able leadership and guidance, the STIP 2020 process will surely realize its goal to be building a technologically self-reliant India for society good. Thank you for your inspiring words, sir. We are grateful to Professor Sharma for his consistent guidance and encouragement in taking forward this event and the SIP 2020 process. My hearty thanks to Dr. Akhilesh Gupta for his support and motivation. Thanks to Shri Abhishek Singhji and the MyGov team for contributing and participating in this endeavor. A special thanks to the officials of DST, Office of the BSA, the Minister's Office, and various other ministries, departments, and agencies for extending support to an event of such stature and magnanimity. A huge shout to the organizing team of STIP 2020 Secretariat and the Science Policy Forum for their tireless efforts and dedication in planning and organizing this event. I must say, this event would have not been possible without them. And last but not least, I would like to thank our live audience for the active participation and engagement in making this event a success. This is just to prepare you that I would say, do join us for more such enriching discussions with various thought leaders in the In Conversation With series. I'm sure together we will take forward the spirit of Vigyan Se Vikas in building an Atmanirbhar Bharat. Until then, take good care of yourself, stay safe, and have a great evening. With this, we end the live stream session.